This is the Zeus architecture. Today we're showing off graphics and other accelerators, which is a key part of this GPU design. We're showing off Lightning, which is our path tracing accelerator, as well as Apollo, which is our electromagnetic wave simulator. All right, Antonio, let's run Glowstick on Lightning and let's see what happens.
Okay.
All right, while it loads, let's talk about OpenUSD and MaterialX and this other thing you have running.
Okay, so Glowstick, our path tracing implementation, is a path tracer rendering engine, which is completely based on OpenUSD and OpenShading language, OSL. So what is happening right here is that our test scene is being loaded into the memory and then into our hardware for computing the acceleration structures required to produce the intersection results necessary for a path tracing algorithm to be implemented.
All right, let's take a look at the first frame that just popped up.
Okay, fantastic. We have a first frame already. As you can see, it's a little bit noisy because path tracing is a progressive algorithm, specifically is recursive. We toss a bunch of camera rays into the scene. The rays are simulated light rays. It's a bit counterintuitive because normally rays coming from lights, right? But we can also do the opposite process. We can cast camera rays, let them interact with the materials, accumulate the results of those interactions, and as they bounce around, and then they will finally hit a light source, and that will give us the radius required to produce the correct illumination. As the frames coming in, more and more information is accumulated until it converges to a nice natural thing.
Okay, Antonio, we are 2 frames out of 9 in right now, but we also have the same scene being rendered on a competitor GPU.
Yes, here we have NVIDIA IRA running exactly the same scene with exactly the same settings on an NVIDIA board GeForce 4090.
On this NVIDIA GPU, this render takes 0.51 seconds, and we're projecting that on a single Zeus chiplet, that the same render will take 0.3 seconds. And across 4 chiplets, it's going to be 4 times faster than that as well. So let's talk about this for a second. I think this is an important topic, and we've gotten a lot of questions about how are chips designed? How does this work? So essentially, what we're doing right now is we are running the exact logic blocks that are going to be implemented inside the ASIC. We're running them inside an FPGA today. FPGAs are a very standard way to develop, test, and verify both the hardware and the software that we develop. And so right now, what you see running here is the actual implementation that will go into the ASIC as well. Right now, we're running one engine at 100 megahertz. That is relatively low speed and not a lot of engines, obviously. In the ASIC, in a 5-nanometer chiplet, we'll have 64 engines at 1.2 gigahertz. And because it's the same logic that's running in the FPGA and the ASIC, we have a very, very accurate way to estimate in a real render what the performance differential is going to be. This is our way to test the functionality and the performance of Lightning. But now that this is done, I actually want to also show, like what Antonio was saying, I want to show a little bit about how path tracing works. You can see when we have our first frame that it's really noisy. I'll play this through. And as we send more rays to the scene, it gets less and less noisy.
Let's talk about a little bit about the actual shading of the scene, because we are entering this domain. Okay, so what happens when the light ray interacts with the material? It's actually a small, full-blown physical simulation of the physics laws behind how light interacts with different materials. And this is known as shading. And in a path tracer, shaders are very different from traditional shaders as you would understand in a raster graphics context. They are more definitely more difficult to achieve because they try to solve the the rendering equation, which is a very sophisticated integral. It's not difficult per se in terms of understanding, but it's difficult because it requires so many samples in order to produce meaningful results. So choosing the right samples and the amount of samples that we can handle is determined by essentially by the power of the hardware that backs the solution. So when we're looking at a solution such as NVIDIA IRA, it's a very powerful solution where both acceleration and intersections are performed on the board, but also the shading is performed on the board, taking advantage of the millions of threads that CUDA cores enable. In our solution at the moment, our shading is performed on the CPU. But in a final solution, that it will be implemented in the compute cores of our GPU.
Director of R&D, and he's been working on a very special project. We're going to show a quick demo of this very special project, which is electromagnetic wave simulation.
Well, so after we had some success with the hardware accelerator Lightning for ray tracing, we decided to look at other areas where this could also be beneficial, and we landed on looking into different physics use cases. And since light is on the electromagnetic spectrum, it felt natural to look into EM more. So that's what we did. So I'll get this running. Okay, now that's pulling up. We'll talk a little bit about EM sim, why it's important. So EM sim, if I'm going to demystify it a little bit, it's imagine anything that has any kind of wireless capabilities, any kind of scanner, or anything that uses any kind of light. So these are things like an antenna radiating energy, or an MRI or a CT scanner that's putting out a pulse and getting information back. It's silicon photonics and optics, radar and LiDAR. And one maybe commonly less known use case is electromagnetic interference and PCBs. So these are things that you don't really think about when you think about EM, but when you're designing PCBs, this is something that's really important to keep in mind for different compliance testing. Let's move over to the simulation. So this is a simulation of a silicon photonics crystal waveguide. You'll notice that it's 850 by 850, that's the number of cells in the simulation. So when you're running an EM simulation, you have to cut it up into discrete pieces. Each one of these cells is 25 nanometers in length. Now you'll notice this color kind of projecting out at us. And if you look at this heat map, you'll kind of see what that means. This is actually the amplitude of the electric field propagating throughout. So how this works is we have all these pores drilled into this piece of silicon. And what happens is, as the electric field propagates out, it disperses off of the pores. And what's left is the remaining piece that propagates down the actual waveguide. Let's talk about the hardware that we're running this on. So similar to Lightning, we have a dedicated hardware engine that does electromagnetic simulation. And we're modeling that on a LVO-U50 FPGA. It's in there. All right, I don't know if you want to open it or not.
Yeah, let's do it.
Yep. So it's this little PCIe card right there. It's running at 100 megahertz, so very slow. It only has one engine on this. And this is just a prototype, what the IP is doing. When we get the same IP, we put it into a full GPU solution, we can do several engines per chiplet. We can do a higher clock, and we'll have full control of the memory interfaces to make it way faster, namely 300 times faster than the B200. Now, another interesting thing that we do is you'll notice that you can kind of see the results being visualized as the simulation is running. Now, this is something that all the top EM simulators do not do. So the simulation is actually computing the data right now, but as it's running, we're generating each frame. So I can actually scroll back and go to the past frames, and it resets and it continues running the simulation.